Good afternoon, and thank you so much for joining us. We are Hanneke van Proostdij and David Taylor. We're the directors of Voices of Music. We are happy that Nicholas McGegan is here with us today. We'll first go over a bit of housekeeping. Feel free to use the chat to say hello and let us know where you're listening from. You can also type in the chat if you're having any technical issues, or you can call Greta, whose phone number I will put in the chat. She'll be on standby ready to answer any questions you have. If you have any content-related questions, please put those in the Q&A tab. We'll be collecting all of those and presenting them at the end for Nick to answer. Finally, in a few days, we'll be sending out a link to the recording of this webinar for all of you to revisit.
It's my great pleasure today to introduce Nicholas McGegan. Nick is, of course, one of the top conductors in the world, and he has conducted at over 50 different orchestras, including the San Francisco Symphony, the LA Phil, and the New York Philharmonic, to name just a few. But there is so much more. Opera? Yes, all opera is great and small. Contemporary music? Check. Chamber music? Numerous performances, awards, and premieres. Solo keyboard? Accompany singers? Baroque and classical flute? Absolutely fabulous. Awards? Too many to count, but let's mention the OBE, or Officer of the Order of the British Empire. Nick has a great website, and you can subscribe for the very latest on his many projects. Although he has always had a worldwide career, Nick has dramatically transformed the early music scene here in the Bay Area. He turned Philharmonia Baroque Orchestra into an international powerhouse, and with his keen eye for talent, promoted the careers of many of the legendary stars in early music performance today. Nick can at any moment take out a sheet of music paper and write a composition or cadenza, and can magically transform a hopeless, illegible manuscript into a concert highlight. In addition to his performance and directing skills, Nick has always been on the cutting edge of musicological research. Please welcome our last year's Audience Choice Award winner, Nick McGegan.
Hi, everybody. I hope you can see and hear me. I'm going to be showing a lot of images later on. So at a certain point, I will disappear and all sorts of much nicer looking 18th century drawings and prints will magically appear on your screen. But I need to introduce what I'm going to talk about first, so you get to look at me, I'm afraid, in my little office in Berkeley. The title of this thing is Handel's Operatic Year. And what I'm going to do basically is precisely that, but not starting, as it were, with January the 1st, but more like a sort of Handelian tax year, beginning in April, May, and running through to the next April, May. And we'll see what he did more or less every month as the year progresses until the next one rolled by the following spring. Handel, between 1710 and 1741, composed over 30 Italian operas. And for most of these, he was also the manager of the company. He also had to help select the libretti, engage the best singers he could find, engage the orchestra, and then rehearse and conduct the performances. In addition, he had extra financial liabilities, which in the perilous world of opera meant that sometimes there was a threat that the whole enterprise could sink. Indeed, in the late 1730s, that is precisely what happened, and Handel pretty much went bankrupt. So before beginning this journey through Handel's year, just a few remarks about the operatic season in London, which mirrors exactly that of the social season of the upper classes. Whether Handel was composing for the King's Theatre or for Covent Garden, the vast majorities of his operas were performed in the months January to May, excluding the 4 weeks of Lent, where no opera was allowed. A few exceptions to this were some operas like Tamerlano, which was performed in October 1724, Riccardo Primo in November, and a couple, Lotario and Floridante, that were performed in December. Aside from these new compositions, the rest of the season, operatic season that is, was taken up with revivals and pasticcios. Now, pasticcios are, as it were, 18th century recycling. You took arias by in this case Handel, but sometimes other people, and you stitch them together like a patchwork quilt to form a new work, tack them onto a libretto, and the result was an opera in which the singers already knew the arias because they came from another work. Operas in the theatres were performed on Tuesdays and Saturdays, the rest of the work, rest of the week being reserved for plays. They normally began at 6 in the evening, and because there were no intermissions to speak of, they would be over about 9 or 10 in the evening, after which the rich would go out and play cards, have supper, dance, and generally get up to no good, sometimes until dawn. Their day normally began at midday, so their whole clock was a little different. As spring approached, Handel also had to work on what are known as benefit performances. These are ones where a particular star could say, tonight is my benefit night, all my friends will come, they will buy lots of tickets. And the idea was that that singer would reap the benefits, the financial rewards, once the expenses had been taken away. And for these, it would be expected that Handel would have to write extra arias, especially for Madame so-and-so or Mr. Signor so-and-so. And we have a few lists of what they looked like. By springtime, end of April, May, one never knows in England, of course, the beau monde, the people who actually paid and bought the tickets, had fled the capital for their country estates, or to try and restore their health by taking that rather disgusting healthy water at the spa in Bath. Generally, they got better because they'd stopped drinking port, and port was served in lead glasses and lead bottles. So they started, once they stopped ingesting all that lead, they generally felt better. Sometimes singers and the musicians would join this exodus performing in country houses and in the fashionable spas for extra money. Also, we must remember that theatres could often get insufferably hot and stuffy, especially in the spring. In Radamisto performance in April 27, 1720, one of Handel's biographers wrote, "If persons who are now living and who were present at that performance may be credited, the applause it received was almost as extravagant as his Agrippina had excited the crowds of Venice. Many who forced their way into the house," that is the theatre, "with an impetuosity but ill-suited to their rank and sex, actually fainted through the excessive heat and closeness of the theatre." So you try to get out of the theatre before you fainted. Of course, in the winter, sometimes the theatres were freezing, as we'll see, and they had to light bonfires in there, or little fires, just so that people wouldn't freeze to death. Much of Handel's day-to-day calendar is unknown to us, but we do know that each summer, whenever he possibly could, he went into the British countryside for a little vacation. We don't know the dates of many of them, but occasionally he'd write, and a dated letter, for example, on the 29th of June, 1736, Handel writes to the Earl of Shaftesbury, "My Lord, on my return to town from the country, where I stayed longer than intended." Well, we know that he left on June the 10th at the earliest, because the last performance of Atalanta had been on the 9th. So he had a scant 3-week vacation. Many of his manuscripts, and of course, many of the performance dates, are known. His manuscripts are often dated. And we know that at some time in the late spring, he must have begun to plan out what the next season would be. Many of his cast sang from year to year, so he was very sure, if you like, who was going to be singing next season. But very occasionally, a star from Venice or Dresden would be engaged by letter. So we knew that, for example, Signora Tozzoni was going to come over in the fall sometime and be ready. But of course, travel was difficult, so you never knew exactly when someone was going to arrive. So you had to be a little bit flexible. Sometimes Handel, as in 1719, traveled abroad himself to engage singers personally and to entice them with offers of, let's face it, enormous fees to come to London. The singers, of course, got paid a lot more than the composer. Once he knew who the singers were likely to be, he and his fellow managers could start to select subjects for possible subjects for operas. Make sure that all the libretti had suitable roles for the stars they hoped to engage. In the earlier years of the Royal Academy of Music, that's Handel's opera company, he was by no means the only composer. Bononcini and Porta also wrote works. And so he had to be to sort of steer clear, because the librettists also wrote for other singers, other composers. So sometimes he said, I would like to do that one. Bononcini can have that one. Handel's collaborators, and this is where we're going to go to images now. So Handel's collaborators on the libretti were an interesting lot. So let's hope that this now, your screen should now go black. Let us try this one. That should be black. But are you now seeing a person?
Yep. This is good.
Good. You're not seeing the most handsome man you've ever seen in your life, I think. This is John James Heidegger, a native of Zurich, who was linked to the earliest productions at the King's Theatre. In fact, before Handel arrived, he came in around 1707. What he actually did is little up for grabs, if you like. He certainly did play. If you look at this look at this drawing, which is by Marcellus Laroon, and it's taking place in Montague House, you can see the man with the enormous spectacles playing the harpsichord. That is, in fact, Heidegger himself. He was the impresario of the operas, but not only that, but also of masquerades. Now, masquerades, here's Heidegger again. This is Cozzoni, is the little lady on the left. The tuneful scarecrow, as he's called in the poem underneath, it says Farinelli or Senesino, probably Farinelli, and the man with a very smug-looking ugly mug on the right hand there is, in fact, Heidegger. This was painted or is etched by a friend of Handel's later on called Guppy, who was also a bit of a cartoonist, and he's the person who actually did a cartoon of Handel as a pig playing the organ. So the tuneful scarecrow, as she's named there in the poem, is Cozzoni, and we'll meet her later. Masquerades, and here is a picture of one from 1724 at the King's Theatre by Grisoni, were absolutely everything that class-bound aristocrats hated, but also secretly adored. Because if you dressed up, if you were a duchess, you could dress up as a chambermaid and pretend to be somebody else. You could escape from being your high class person and become a totally different one. If you were a chambermaid, you could dress up as a duchess and try and get away with it. This meant that class barriers were broken down. And this, of course, caused a storm of moral outrage, principally by the Bishop of London, who is almost always a prude. He's the person who disapproved of Handel's Messiah being done at Covent Garden by a group of Italian singers. It destroyed the social order, but of course they were immensely popular. So much so that the King, George II, actually later on made him master of the royal revels. His house, surprisingly, still survives. This is Heidegger's house. It's in Maids of Honor Row in Richmond. And one of the scene painters, perhaps Jolly, painted one of the rooms. Here you can see the fireplace. And here's two bits of the wall paintings. The one on the left is actually Basel. The one on the right obviously isn't. It's a little further east. But these paintings do survive. In fact, they were covered over with brown paint until about the 1950s. When the owner of the house thought there might be something there and decided to give it a clean. And he found these underneath. And there's a whole room of them. They're absolutely wonderful. We just go back a little bit to Heidegger. He once made a bet with Lord Chesterfield that Lord Chesterfield could not find an uglier man in London than himself. And Lord Chesterfield apparently lost the bet. He worked with Handel up till 1734 and a certain amount after that. Our next person is Nicola Ayim, who was also a foreigner, this time born in Rome. And he came to England as a cellist, composer, historian, and amateur artist. But his main task was to be the arranger of libretti. His first one was Terzio in 1713. And after the establishment of the Academy of Music, he did Radamisto, Giulio Cesare, and Rodolinda. He stopped working for Handel in 1728. His main rival was Rolli, who arrived in 1715. He was a bit of an arrogant fellow. He wrote an Italian version of Paradise Lost of Milton, which he immodestly said was the most exact transposition from one language into another that has ever been read. Rolli was also apparently extremely difficult to get on with, and his works for Handel were Floridante, Scipione, and Riccardo Primo. But after the foundation of the Opera of the Nobility, he deserted Handel and went and worked for the rival firm, which included the singer Farinelli. He didn't terribly like Handel's operas, referred to them as worthless. Riva is the next one. Riva had no great opinion of Rolli, another one of them. He said, and he had a low, very low opinion of Haim. He said, Haim, a Roman and a cellist who is a complete idiot as far as letters are concerned, boldly passing from the orchestra to the heights of Parnassus, he has for the last 3 years been adapting, or rather making worse, the old librettos, which were already bad enough in their original form. So, had quite a committee of people to choose the libretti. And he had to make sure, of course, that he had good roles for people. This is one of the people he had to make sure he gave top roles to, top heroic roles. This is Senesino. This is actually a rather wonderful sculpture by Louis-François Roubilliac from about 1734-5. It's just after he'd stopped working for Handel. Here, looking very heroic. And all castrato heroes in the King's Theatre days were sung by him. Trying to find good roles for the ladies was tough, especially in the 1720s, because he had two of them, Faustina and Cuzzoni, and they had to be equal roles. Eventually, if the hero was going to marry, he could only marry one of them. But three acts, essentially, are spent giving equal time, equal billing to the two divas, whose supporters hated each other much more than the two ladies did. Charles Burney said about the opera Admeto, which has indeed two singers, two soprano roles that are trying to balance. He said, it seems impossible for two singers of equal merit to tread the stage a parte eguale, which means getting equal time. For as two people to ride upon the same horse, it is impossible to ride without one being behind the other. They couldn't actually appear side by side. Sometimes there were political considerations. It is well known with the Hanoverian monarchs that they got on especially badly with all their children. So an opera in which an heir to the throne has problems with his father is likely to cause problems. And that indeed happened in Floridante, where the rightful heir to the throne ends up being imprisoned and he's eventually delivered. And it caused great applause in the audience to the annoyance of any royal person who got the message. Sometimes if an opera was considered to happen too close to home, as happened in Sosame, the plot could be moved, as it was in that case, to Sardis, which was thought to be far enough away. Conversely, if you wished to flatter a monarch, you made sure that you had nice roles for kings or emperors or Julius Caesar, for example. So Julius Caesar is actually dedicated to the king. Ricardo Primo, which is the opera that Handel wrote to get his British citizenship, is dedicated to one of Ricardo Primo's successors, George II. Also, the librettos were vastly changed for British taste. Minor characters were often removed, comic characters were removed, and because the arias in Handel's operas are generally longer than the Italian originals, just the sheer number of arias was reduced. Also, keeping the amount of recitative was reduced. Johann Sigismund Kusser, who was a German living in London, noted various advice that he was given in 1704. Number 17 of these is, prepare yourself with music to fit British taste. No pathos, certainly, and short, short recitatives. He knew the Brits couldn't take it. This meant, of course, that sometimes the texts didn't make a great deal of sense. And so when you had a libretto, you actually had to put in some of the text that wasn't set, just so that people could have an idea of what was really going on. This is from Handel's Tezio, and you'll see on both sides, the English and the Italian side, that there's a whole section in the middle of the page on both sides with little virgole, as they're called, little commas. That means that it's in the original libretto, but it's not set. But you have to read it to find out what's happening. Otherwise, it would be completely incomprehensible. Sometimes a character, for example, would read a letter, and the letter is not read out to the audience, but they can read it in the libretto. Saves a bit of time. Having chosen the libretto, he then had to make sure that it was all suitable for the cast, and then he could start writing the music. Generally speaking, Handel and any sensible person in the 18th century tried to write music in the summer, between July and September. This is because nothing else was going on. All the aristocrats were out of town. And also, really, more importantly, the days were nice and long, which cut down composing by candlelight. And the warm weather meant that he could open the windows because the air was fresher and cleaner and so much different from London in the winter, which was the capital of fog and coal smoke. Everybody, right up to Mendelssohn, commented on how filthy London was, really up until the 1950s. He wrote very quickly. He could often finish a score in a few weeks. And then what he did was to start sending the music out to the singers so that they could approve their arias. And we'll see how that happens. He then got the arias back. He made various changes, transposings, and so on. And sometimes, very close to the premiere, he'll put a completion date on the opera. Now, sometimes this is alarmingly close. For example, with Alcina, the completion date is given as April the 8th, 1735, and the premiere was April the 16th. Now, can't possibly be that he'd really finished it at that point. That really just means that he'd put the ink onto the viola, he'd written out the viola and trumpet parts, the bits that didn't need to be memorized. Obviously, the singers had had their music ages before, and in Alcina, there's actually some ballet, so they can't just have learned it all in a few days. Plus, of course, we have to remember that everything has to be copied by hand. And so, you need a bit of time to make four violin parts. And sometimes there are two dates. There's a date when the draft is finished, which can sometimes be several months before the opera finishing date. And that's him filling in the parts. And we can actually see him doing this. Here is an aria from Act One of Handel's Orlando, which, as you can see, he didn't end up using this particular bit of it. This is an aria called Fammi Combattere. And you can see basically that what he's doing is writing the voice part, the bass part, and a few little bits of fiddle part to show what he wants in the bits where the singer is not singing, or just to remind him. Sometimes, not in this case, but sometimes it'll also have figures to show what harmony he's going to write. But when he actually came to write it, sometimes he changes his mind, but the figures stay there, making actual nonsense because they're just part of the composition process. He seems to have written the arias mostly in sequence, and then he wrote out the recitatives without the music. We have a little example from Orlando here. You can see there's a piece of recitative in scene 7 from Act 3 on the left, which has the music, but the words keep going because he'd already written them out. But he decided what he'd do is rather than have it as secco recitative, he would have that bit set with the orchestra. So he crossed out the words he'd already written, put on a new page, and has orchestral recitative there. The arias are written, so the recits are written after all the arias come back from the singers in case of transpositions, so that he could write the recits so that they would lead approximately to the key in which the thing was going to be sung. And in some of the arias, you'll see un tono più alto, a tone up, a tone down, and so on. Also, the last thing that gets written is the overture, just like Mozart writing the overture to Don Giovanni practically the day before the performance, because that doesn't need to be memorized, it just needs to be copied for the musicians. He's composing on quarto gatherings of 8 pages. And so as soon as an aria had been copied, as soon as an aria had been written in this kind of form, but complete, with the voice part, the bass part, and a few little extra bits, that could then go to the singers. And he could keep composing. So you can imagine that Handel's house was a hive of activity, pretty much all the year. This is what it looked like in the 1880s. It's not the house on the extreme left. It's the next one in, 25 Upper Brook Street. And you can see his front door there. The two little windows beside the front door are his lower parlor. That's where he sold copies of his portrait, sold the tickets, sold music. Then the next floor up with the three windows is his main living room. The next floor above that is his bedroom. And the upper floor there was added after Handel's death. If you go to the place now, it's a museum, and the house to the left is now known as the Hendrix house, because that's where Jimi Hendrix lived. And he lived on the two windows, that two little dormer windows that you can see on the left there. That's the Handel Hendrix house. And if we take a look at it, this is the living room. And we know this is where he held rehearsals. We know what color it was because he was the first person to live there. So they scraped the paint back, and that was the color that was there. That's a copy of Handel's harpsichord. This is what it looks like when it's set up for a concert now. And this is perhaps how it would have been set up for some rehearsals. Behind it is the composition room, which is probably where they had dinner as well. And here is a rather wonderful painting of Handel in his I'm not dressed to go out gear. He's not wearing a wig. He's wearing a hat, a nice sort of felt thing or velvet hat to keep him warm. And he's writing beside his clavichord with a looking as if he has a slight headache, I must say. One of the things that's happening rather wonderfully in Handel's house is that they've managed to get hold of the bottom floor, which is rather terrific. And it's on a 99-year lease. So they're going to be able to open Handel's shop again, his lower parlor. And they're also going to open up the kitchens, which supplied as what Mannering calls the uncommon portion of food and nourishment, which Mannering says was needed to sustain Handel. When this project is finished, the restoration of the kitchen, it will be the only fully restored Georgian kitchen in London. And whether it'll actually be used or not, I don't know. I've been in there before it was restored. I think it's rather wonderful, and something I think that Handel would thoroughly approved of, is that the whole restoration of the kitchen is known as the Hallelujah Project. I can just think that Handel would have approved of that immensely. It's clear that he worked sometimes late into the night. Some of the manuscripts are timed, saying finished at 10 in the evening. He also worked on days that for us would be holidays. Faramondo was finished on Christmas Eve. Cerce was began on December the 26th. So let's hope that he had a roaring fire, good supply of candles, coffee, claret, and tobacco for his pipe. We've seen the sort of materials that the singers got, this sort of one-line thing. And the libretti were probably at this stage in manuscript, though they would later be published. And we'll see, well, there's Handel's bedroom. Got my put that in. That is the room where he died. We know he had a red bedspread. This is what a Handel libretto looks like. This is the ones that were printed actually just before the performance. And this is a particularly fascinating one. This is Radamisto, because this is the prompter's copy. So if we take a look there at the first page of it, you can see it says Mrs. Turner Robinson. She was a singer. And it says a chair and a table. So he knew what set to put up. And it says Mrs. Turner Robinson, 10 women. That means 10 supernumeraries on stage. We think of a Handel opera and we see a cast of six. There were always lots and lots of people on stage, and we'll see pictures of that. Tells you which side of the stage they should be on. And there are other details when people come on and off, when the set changes happen, and so on. As soon as the singers got their music, exciting things could happen. They're, of course, quite a headstrong bunch, these divas. And so complaints generally fall into several categories. General dissatisfaction with the role they've been allotted, dislike of a particular aria, and musical changes within the aria. Let's take the first one, and we'll take Benedetto Baltasari. Here he is. And he sang the role of Fra Arte in Radamisto, and he wrote a letter complaining, saying he had never acted anything in any other opera below the character of a sovereign, or at least a prince of the blood, and that now he was appointed to be a captain of the guard and a pimp. So the libretto was changed to give it, to raise his status and to give him a bit of love interest, and he got a solo scene, and that seems to have mollified him. Funny enough, when Anastasia Robinson, Anastasia Robinson is our next one. Here she is. She ended up as Countess of Peterborough, but she had to wait an awful long time before she could marry her boyfriend. And so she ended up as a countess. She didn't like the role of Matilda in Ottone, but her worries are not of a snobbish nature at all. She worries whether she's right for the part. And we have preserved two lengthy letters to Giuseppe Viva. Unfortunately, they're not dated, but it gives you an idea of how things were. I won't read all this, but not knowing how to give yourself the trouble of coming here, I must do it in writing. I'm very sensible that the music of my part is extremely fine, but I must assure the character causes it to be of that kind which no way suits my capacity. Nature designed me a peaceful creature, and it is true as strange that I am a woman and cannot scold. She then goes on to say how she would like this angry aria to be changed into a sweet one, and so on. And in the second letter, she says that she daren't actually approach Handel himself about this. I dare not ask Mr. Handel to change the songs, but do you believe if I was to wait on Lady Darlington, she might have power over him? I cannot be an abominable scold. You you might be my friend, and so on and so on, but said, you know that nature has made me a patient grizzle by nature. That's like the character Griselda. And I can never be a ptarmigant. Now, she's very clever there, mentioning Lady Darlington, because Lady Darlington was, in fact, the king's half-sister. And so half-sister might indeed be able to have some influence over Handel, given her royal connections. And indeed, Handel did change the part to make it work better for her. Another change is in the opera Tamerlano. And we'll go to this chap in a little cartoon by Zanetti. His name is Borozini, and he has a completely different reason for an opera to get changed. The score of Tamerlano was finished on the 23rd of July, 1724. There was a big gap before the premiere. And what seems to have happened is that the role of Bajazet was originally for Alexander Gordon, a Scottish tenor, but Francesco Borozini came along, and he had just sung the role of Bajazet in an opera by Gasparini, in which there was enormous role for him, including dying on stage, something that happens almost never in a Handel opera. And there's a note in the Gasparini score which says that the whole idea of having this great scena where Borozini dies at the end was actually his own idea. Handel made extensive rewrites at the end, incorporated this new scene, which showed off the tenor dying on stage, and was, of course, a huge success. With Ottone, we have a different case of a change, because the singer hadn't arrived. He'd finished it on August the 10th, and by October the 27th, it said that Madame Cuzzoni, and here she is daily expected from Italy. So the opera had been finished a couple of months beforehand. This is a wonderful drawing by Philippe Mercier of her. She was going to be given the part of Teofane, and that part had originally been designed for Madame Durastanti, and we'll meet her in a minute. Cuzzoni took one look at the opera and frankly refused to sing the opening aria, Falsa Immagine, and Handel threatened to throw her out of the window if she didn't. She clearly felt that it was just not right for her. She was a virtuoso singer with enough trills to last a lifetime. But what she really wanted, or what she really objected to, is that an aria, her first number in her first show in London, was a cast-off. It had been written for somebody else, and she wanted something that had been written specially for her. She did eventually, perhaps with bad grace, agree to sing it, and it was a triumph. And what seems rather weird is her rather odd costume that she chose, because singers provided their own costumes in those days. It was a combination of brown and silver, which I must say seems a bit dowdy, but it actually caused a fashion furore in London at the time. Same thing, actually, with Carestini refused to sing Verdi Prati in Alcina. He thought it was too simple. If we take a look at this aria, this is Fammi Combattere, we've seen before. This is Handel actually changing things, having got the aria back from the singer, as it were, saying, don't like this, don't like that. You can see in the top there that two lines, I think I can use my cursor here, that two lines of coloratura have been cut out. But the orchestra parts were not composed. So all it's only cut out in this bit. And then the orchestra parts have been added after the cut has been made. Down here, you can see he's made a pig's ear of this bit. And the original parts, the original coloratura is here with a bass part. And then it wasn't approved of. Here's the new coloratura. He had to add a new bass part to it. And that, after that, he adds the orchestra parts. And you can see the viola part mysteriously jumps up a line because he's borrowed the viola line there to fit it. So this is how he's really tailor-making, like haute couture, he's tailor-making an aria to fit a particular singer. Senesino, this is a Senesino aria, particularly liked fast arias in B-flat, and there's one in almost every opera. Sometimes two. That was his favorite key for doing that sort of thing. And there are other operas such as Ariodante where similar cuts happen. It comes therefore as a bit of a surprise that in certain roles like Tolomeo in Giulio Cesare, almost every single one of the arias was written for somebody else, but the singer was somewhat low down the pecking order, so he had to put up with it. The result is a wonderful character, and actually a very nasty character, a dangerous, spoilt brat, Tolomeo, who would do really well on the Jerry Springer show, I imagine, apart from the murders that he also committed. I'm going to omit the stuff about orchestras, except to say that it is known how big Handel's orchestra was. It varied from time to time. A lot of them were Italians, some were Germans, very few were Brits. One of them is kind of an interesting chap. He's called William Douglas, who's known as the Black Prince, who was from the Caribbean. And he was one of the royal trumpeters. We know probably that his timpanist, at least in Riccardo Primo, was English, because whereas all the dynamic things saying forte and piano are in Italian, in the timpani part it says soft and loud. Maybe the guy didn't speak Italian well enough. Occasionally, as in Alcina and Ariodante, there was dance music, and here is his choreographer, Madame Salé. This is a painting by Quentin de Latour. And she must, of course, had the music well in advance for those, unless in some operas, of course, they provided their own music. But in Ariodante and Alcina, it's by Handel. Exactly how they rehearsed is a little bit of a mystery, but there's one thing we can be fairly certain of. They didn't rehearse in the theater. For a start, the theaters in the winter were freezing, they were dirty, and they were being used for plays. So you rehearsed wherever you possibly could away from the rough and tumble of the theater. And there are two places that this seems to have happened. One is Handel's house, after 1723, the house that I've shown you pictures of, and the other was in noblemen's houses. You rehearsed, you let the nobleman sit and listen, and you made use of their heat and light where necessary. You also rehearsed during the day. Mrs. Delaney here was one of the Handel's greatest fans. She was known earlier in her life as Mrs. Pendarves, and then she married the Reverend Delaney, and this is the portrait of her in old age when she became a great friend of Queen Charlotte. She attended a rehearsal of Alcina on the 11th of April, that's 1735, that's 5 days before the premiere. She writes, "Yesterday morning, my sister and I went to Mr. Handel's house for the rehearsal of Alcina. I think it is the best that he has ever made. While Mr. Handel was playing his part, I could not help thinking him a necromancer in the midst of his own enchantments." So here we have what you might think of as a piano rehearsal. Handel's playing the orchestra parts. The singers are playing it. They're working out their stagings. Now we have some pictures of things like this, and two of these paintings by Ricci are in fact in the Center for British Art at Yale. Here you see two singers with the keyboard and a cellist and a few people listening on and a dog who really doesn't seem to like opera sitting there at the bottom. Here is another one of the ones at Yale. The man in red is Nicolini, who sang Rinaldo. And interestingly, you'll notice the cellist in both cases do not have their own music and they're both wearing spectacles. Cellists had to play off the keyboard parts. So, and you can tell in one of these paintings, there's another one in Castle Howard in Yorkshire. The central painting there in the background is not there and there's a window. And you can tell it's being rehearsed during the day. Here they're working out the blocking and so on, which is ruled by etiquette and so on. Some of the actors, of course, were wonderful. Nicolini, who's the chap on the right here with Cozzoni, was apparently a marvelous actor. It was said in a review in the Tatler, every limb and every finger contributes to the parts he acts, insomuch that a deaf man may go along with him in the sense of it. There is scarce a beautiful posture in an old statue that he does not plant himself in, as the different circumstances of the story give rise to it. He would act like a prince, even in delivering a letter. Some, like Farinelli, who never actually sang for Handel, were basically stick insects. They couldn't act at all, and they didn't try. Here we have a cartoon of Senesino, Cozzoni, and Bernstadt, and the person I want you to look at is the little page boy in the middle, because their dresses always, the ladies, because they had huge dresses, always had page boys. And they had to have tremendous care to avoid page turns, traffic jams. The libretto of Radamisto, as we mentioned before, lists up to 10 supernumerary ladies in one scene where only one character is actually named. And here you can see another one in a beautiful Venetian painting. And here, in a painting of the Teatro Reggio in Turin, if you look at the stage, there are soldiers in the back, the two page boys, supernumeraries on the back on the other side. That's the most wonderful painting by Oliviero from 1740. Art mirrors life, of course. In something like that, no court would be a king and queen would never be alone, even when they were taking they didn't take showers, but even when they had what we might consider private moments, even for the Queen of England, giving birth had to be done in public, in the presence, believe it or not, of the Archbishop of Canterbury, to show that the boy was or girl was legitimate. In the memoirs of Tate Wilkinson, he writes about the little page boys. He said, the ladies wore velvet petticoats heavily embossed, which were extremely inconvenient and troublesome. And so always a page boy was there behind to hear the lover's secrets and to keep the train in graceful decorum. If two princesses met on the stage, with the frequent stage crossing then practiced, it would now seem truly entertaining to behold a page dangling at the tail of each heroine. They sometimes actually bumped into each other. Here is Fabri, he's another tenor, who Mrs. Delaney heard in rehearsal and thought, he's a good singer, but I doubt his voice is strong enough for the stage. So she must obviously have heard another of Handel's daytime rehearsals. The day before the performance, the bilingual libretto would have been printed. And we presume that there must have been some rehearsal of stage effects, chariots, flying chariots, Amorini coming down from the sky. And we know that sometimes it didn't work out. One of the most interesting is this, which is in Act One of Orlando, where you see on the left a little piece of score. The two lines of music underneath are the recit that follows. And that is a set change music, which is from the page before, and it's quite long. And there's a cut in it. And then as the stage hands got better and better at changing the set, the long piece of music for the changing the set is shortened and shortened until he says, well, damn that. And he writes a new, completely new one, which is the length of the set change now that the stage hands have got to be good at it. And there you see it there. It's only a few bars long, much shorter than the previous ones. One of the problems of not rehearsing was that things did go wrong, particularly, for example, in Rinaldo, where a lot of sparrows were let loose in a scene with birdsong. that's something they can't possibly have rehearsed. Otherwise, they'd have known, as the Tatler put it, there have been so many flights of birds let loose in this opera that it's feared the house will never get rid of them. And sometimes they make their entrance in other plays in very wrong and improper scenes, besides the inconveniences with which the heads of the audience may suffer from them. In other words, they pooped on the heads of the audiences in other shows. Here is Durastanti. Not a very flattering picture, I must say. But there were no understudies. And so singers had to sing unless they were really too ill to perform. And in the case of Durastanti, she found herself singing heavily pregnant in 1721 until almost the last minute. She sort of had a few days off, gave birth, and the daughter that she produced even then had the king as a godfather. Let's go to cut a little bit here so we don't run out of time. One thing the audience seems not to have been terribly concerned about is the length of an opera. They started at 6, no intermissions, but they would have lasted 3 or 4 hours. Most people didn't care. The only person who did was this gentleman, who, believe it or not, is Sir Isaac Newton. He said that he'd never been to more than one opera. In Act One, he heard for pleasure. Act Two stretched his patience, and Act Three, he ran away. That was actually Radamisto. Towards the end of the season, there would therefore then be the benefit concerts. And for Cuzzoni's in 1723, she said that she was going to give a benefit. It would begin at 6 p.m. There would be an audience allowed on stage for that. So made nonsense of Ottone, which was the opera that was actually being performed. And she made £700. That is an earl's annual income. Mrs. Turner Robinson, a few years later, included 10 arias by Handel and a bit of Purcell in her benefit. Handel, of course, had to write all those arias for many of these things, sometimes specially, sometimes not. We began by looking at Handel's operatic year, but it's worth considering that just how busy he was. Because aside from writing everything, in 1727-8, he gave 60 performances of his own operas. Of these, Riccardo Primo was written before the season, but Ciro and Tolomeo were composed during it. He also revived Admeto, Alessandro, and Radamisto. And in addition, he had to write all the music for the coronation. So he was a very busy boy. Let's take a look at him. So all this had to be rehearsed under conditions that we modern musicians would find very difficult. How could we have coped without photocopiers and all the benefits of electricity? It is a most humbling experience to consider how Handel managed to achieve all this and how he did so in spite of all the pressures and difficulties in such a way that he could produce so many operatic masterpieces that still have the power to move us today. So let's go back to stopping to share. And there I am again. And it is 4:56, so I'm only a little bit late. Do we have any questions?
Thank you, Nick. That's absolutely fascinating that you shared, and we appreciate it. I think we have time for a couple of questions. There are two questions. The first one is by...
Elliot asks, do you have a favorite among Handel's librettists and a favorite libretto?
That's very hard to say because almost no Handel libretto is original. You know, they're taking from Italian originals and adapted. So when you say it's a libretto by Ayim, it might then actually have been written by somebody else 30 years later. Or in the case, I think it's Ariodante, there's two or three Ariodantes before you get to the one that is actually there. One of the ones that is new is Rinaldo, which was written in English, I believe, first by Aaron Hill. That's certainly a wonderful one. That's the real sort of Indiana Jones meets Italian opera piece. I think the libretto of Orlando is particularly nice because it's so beautifully balanced. The characters are wonderful. It does, interestingly, have a comic character in because Handel for once had a comic actress in the cast, and she sings beautiful music. It's lovely to hear Handel letting his hair down a bit, letting his wig down, I should say. I think that's one of my favorites. I think that Handel cared deeply about the libretto. To what extent the audience cared about the libretto is another matter, because it was, of course, he's writing, with the exception of a few operas like Agrippina, he's writing for an English audience who could only pick up the Italian mostly secondhand from reading the translation of it. The cast's mostly English with a few Italians in there, mostly Italian with a few English people in there. But I think they were more concerned with, the audience is more concerned with the story and the characters rather than the actual words. So it's a slight difference there. Whereas Italian operas written, shall we say, by Metastasio, he wrote them and he published them as poems, published them as literature. And so they became known for their verses. But that doesn't seem to be the case with the English one. The libretto, the texts, shall we call them, are serviceable.
Thank you. Let's move to the next question, which is a follow-up question on this, and we're going to combine two people's questions from Elliot and from Andrea. Would the audience read the libretto before the performance or during the performance? And then the question is, if they read it during the performance, would they bring their own candles, or was there lighting in the theater during the performance?
Okay, let's go backwards. Yes, there was lighting in the if you brought it. If you were grand, you were in a box, and it was your job, basically, you rented the box, you would light it yourself. The Paris Opera had light on all the time. Basically, if you were Madame de Pompadour and you'd spent $25,000 minimum on a dress to go to the opera, you weren't going to sit in the dark. But in England, if the royals were there, this was also true in Naples, if the royals were there, they burnt wax candles. When the royals weren't there, they tended to burn tallow candles, which made it smell like a chip shop. So it was not only dark, but also smelly. The royals sat practically on stage, which is a great place to be seen, not a great place to see the opera. It's also a great place to be shot. So they had guards around them. The libretto would be published, I think, very close to the performance in case there are any changes. I've not seen librettos for benefit nights where the extra arias exist, but they would presumably be just published the day or two before, if they were published, so that you get the correct texts in there. Certainly you could bring your own candles, therefore you did have these little, the librettos are pocket sized and 18th century pockets are quite big. So you could read during. People also drank wine during. You see sometimes in pictures like the Teatro Reggio picture I showed earlier, somebody serving drinks during an opera. Somebody's selling oranges. In Italy, sometimes the boxes would close so that you could get on with something else with your friends behind in your box and just treat the opera as muzak. You could have dinner. You could entertain your mistress. Or whatever.
It's amazing. I think it's hard for us to imagine how many candles would have been needed to light up a theater. And it's also amazing to me that they didn't burn down more often, because how did they manage all those candles?
Well, a number of reasons. First of all, the chandeliers, there are very few lights above the stage. Because of all the stage machinery, the lights on the stage are generally behind the flats, behind the side screens. They could just be changed by the backstage staff as needed. About every half hour, a candle generally dies. another reason, of course, for not doing opera in the summer is the candles melt faster when it's really hot. and especially if you have the windows open, because that creates a howling gale. So they then the risk of fire is great. The Paris Opera, for which we've got details, I think it's about 3,000 or 4,000 candles could be burnt in a night, which is a hell of a lot. I'm just trying to find something here, which of course I won't be able to find now, but it will never be there when I want it. But there is something along the way of costs. I'm not finding it here, but basically the costs for the orchestra and the costs for the candles are not so very different. In other words, you could have an orchestra of 30 and candles, and the candles are about the same price. Candles are not cheap, which is why you didn't light them unless you had to. Also, I should mention that theatres are full of windows, so that you could paint them inside without having to light the candles to paint the thing indoors. It meant you could rehearse during the day if the weather was suitable, and use sunlight at least to rather than have to light candles at all times. There was actually, somebody tried to invent a way, I think it was Heidegger actually, of lighting candles, lots of them simultaneously, but it scared people. There is an engraving of an opera from late in the 18th century, which certainly looks as if one of the string players is changing the candles during the show. One just simply assumes they're viola players because they didn't play as much and they could change the candles in the auditorium. But basically, a chandelier would have to last because you couldn't take it down in the middle of the show. There were chandeliers above the proscenium arch. They would just have to last as long as they could. And the wax, of course, dripped on the heads of the actors, which makes them happy that they wore wigs.
Yeah.
We have a question from Bruce Brown. Hi, Bruce. He says, I'm wondering about a point from near the start of your talk. When they had operas and plays performing in the same theater, did they share the sets? And how did they alternate performances from night to night in terms of the sets?
Well, it's as far as I know, the sets, what you might call generic sets, a palace, a garden, a living room, or whatever, would be there for every performance, depending on what was needed. There is an inventory from Covent Garden from the 1740s, which does list the scenery that they have. And as far as I remember, it does say things like a palace from Ariodante. Now, Ariodante was first performed over about a dozen years beforehand, and it's still listed as being in the theatre. Obviously, if it was a play and say it was a domestic comedy, you'd have a whole series of scenery that would not necessarily be suitable for Giulio Cesare. So they had a lot of scenery that would go according to the piece, but most of the operas are, well, the opera seria. And so your palace, your garden, your prospect of the ocean are pretty much ubiquitous and would go from opera to opera. There's a difference, though, with Orlando, which is 1732-3, where it's actually in the paper, where it's announced that the sets will be new as an attractive thing to make people come. But normally they weren't. And a lot of the singers provided their own costumes. And so the stars, anyway, there's a lady with the rather quaint name of George Ann Bellamy, who wrote one of the autobiographies in which she talks about watching one of her colleagues, a very young colleague, come on stage in a role that I'm sure she thought was too grand for her, wearing a white dress, which she said, of course, looked like dirty yellow under candlelight. And then goes on, I, of course, wore black. because she knew better.
Well, thank you, Nick. I think we're running out of time a little bit. We're going over time. We appreciate your time. We appreciate everything that you have shared. We know that not all the questions have been answered, so we are happy to follow up with that on email with those of you who would like that. But first of all, a big thank you to Nick for speaking with us today, and a big thank you to Greta for your help, and a big thank you to everyone for coming today.
Thanks, Nick. Thanks, everyone, for joining this wonderful presentation, and we'll see you all soon.
Bye.